here we are at the Cooke Family Project, and we're thinking about completing the floor assembly. And Derek, let's start with the conversation about how much insulation, how much foam have we got under that entire assembly?
So we start with the radon guard at the bottom, which is R10. And then what we're standing on here is R8. And then we also have R10 in the Ampex.
What's been your experience with radon, Derek? What are you hearing?
We don't see high levels of radon in this area. We have had a house tested before. I tested my own house, sent it into the Canadian Home Builders Association, and it came back fairly low. So it wasn't as much of a concern, but still a great idea to protect against it.
And interesting enough, the same thing that you're doing to stop radon, you're also stopping moisture. So I wanted to talk about a pretty interesting product called Radon Block. This is a product that has been developed specifically to stop radon and to give you an insulation level. So you always insulate your slabs. Historically, you've been using
Either spray foam or sheet foam, different types of sheet.
So this is an EPS foam, but you'll notice these nodules on the backside. In practice, this actually replaces the need for gravel. Now, you're in a sand environment, you're typically bringing in gravel anyway, or at least stone, for radon, but frankly, this could replace the stone in your application. Could you see that working for you?
Yeah, I think that would be a great idea. It just depends on the soil that you're working with and if we can level it out and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, I think that could definitely.
And obviously the sequencing and so on. So you get that full, that's 2.5 inches of foam, that's typically R10, plus then the nodules, so that I've got an airflow pattern that I can exhaust that radon gas directly to the outside. So in general, we're sealing this around penetrations, laying this down. This takes the place of stone and gives you that path. And obviously this is going to go down pretty simply, and we've got ourselves an R10 insulation. It comes in different thicknesses.
Yeah.
And so we're going to lay that down as part of our assembly. Then over top of that, we're going to use this incredible 20 mil thick liner product that again is a part of the radon block system that allows us to seal off completely any moisture and any radon. What are you typically using under your slabs?
Most of the time we're using a 6 mil poly taped and sealed to all penetrations.
So pretty heavy stuff.
Yeah, that's quite a lot thicker than 6 mil poly.
Pretty heavy even just bringing it in.
Yeah, exactly.
And the concept here is you actually do want to seal it off, and they've provided us with a double-sided butyl tape that we're going to use to seal to each of the penetrations and to the wall. If you wouldn't mind, it's a double-sided tape. Derek, if you wouldn't mind, just I'll help you here, but we just want to take that tape off, that release paper. We're just doing a little demo of it. I don't know if you can get at it or if I can get at it sooner. There we go.
You got it?
Show that carefully. That butyl, what's nice about butyl is it sticks to just about anything, including our ICF construction. And we can imagine we're around the whole perimeter and around individual penetrations. And now we have this really incredible, rugged, rigorous block against moisture and radon.
That's great.
So this radon barrier is kind of interesting because it's designed for full taped seams and edges. You can imagine radon being such an important thing, we definitely want to get it sealed up. So what they recommend as a radon barrier, what you're going to want to do is overlap by roughly 12 inches on every seam, use a double-sided tape on that leading edge. We're just simulating here, obviously. We're going to stick that down along the entire seam, and then Derek, you're going to use the 4-inch tape to tape that off. And you can imagine just how rigorous and rugged that's now going to be from a moisture and a radon perspective. It's not going to take too long. Obviously, we're just simulating it here. Just want to give you a sense of what that looks like. And obviously, there's full instructions available from Radon Environmental. Great partner, frankly. Radon Environmental, really nice company that's providing all of this system to you so that you meet your radon objectives in whatever code jurisdiction you're working with. The other issue, of course, is going to be around penetrations. And we're going to use the same tape, or perhaps a little wider. We're just going to create a joint around a way to seal that off. So we'll have to cut that, but we would just cut and slit that in around that penetration. Wouldn't mind. And we're just going to kind of origami that around that opening. We'll use another piece on the other side here. T- to get that barrier down. Not so bad. What do you think, Derek?
I think that works great.
So in your area, lots of moisture in the sand. Imagining that, stopping that moisture from coming through the slab, moisture alone, even if radon's not a big concern. And so we have three items. One, we wanted to do that radon, and on top of the radon guard, the foam product, now we've got the radon block, which gives us our radon and moisture barrier. And then we wanted to build up that assembly to get to at least R28, R30 was our goal, yeah. Kind of achieve that. And to top it off, of course, gonna be in-floor heating. We've used this cool product from Amvic called Ampex, and it's a combination product. One, it's gonna give us our foam thickness. Two, it gives us this amazing ability just to snap in the radiant floor. You've done a lot of radiant floor for clients. Historically, what have you been using?
Most of the time we use wire mesh to hold it down, so you zip tie the pipes right down to the wire mesh.
And we did that at the other project, yep. And Linda and I just about broke our backs on that one. Yeah. And then we had to come back and snip all the ties off. There seemed to be a concern about it floating up. Is that not a concern?
Yeah, that can be an issue too, and sometimes if the wire mesh isn't straight, the wire mesh can come up, and we can't control how deep the pipe is in the concrete, which can be an issue for using fasteners to fasten interior walls down and such.
Always a little bit of an angst, right?
Yeah.
So in this case, we've shown it going down. It has this really nice, you and I were fiddling with this morning, really nice interlock system so that we get this ability to tie one into the other on two different surfaces. We were finding it went down pretty easily.
It goes down very easy. Yeah.
And then snaps together, feels pretty good. Yeah. You're a little concerned that I was a little heavy and we yeah. might be worried about the nubs, but
they squish down a bit, but they seem to pop right back up.
It seems to be one of the rules of if you're going to use something on the slab, you've done spray foam, you've yeah. used extruded foam. The key is, you know, the right thickness. Don't fiddle around with 1 inch, it breaks too easily.
Yeah.
So no matter what you're using, EPS, XPS, spray foam, at least an inch and a half. In this case, we wanted that higher R value, but this product itself seems pretty rugged, pretty rigorous.
Yeah, it works pretty well, and with all in-floor heat, you pump the concrete, so there's not as much worry about rolling wheelbarrows over top of it and that kind of thing.
That's always some concern, right? So great, so let's get down and just have a look at how that piping goes in, that tubing goes in. So here we have the PEX tubing, cross-link polyethylene. Cool product, this happens to be Ray House Pipe. Lots of great products out there, Uponor, various others. And what's really kind of cool is if we just follow that correctly, we'll just go to 12 inch, I think. Literally, you can almost step on it, Derek, just as you move it back there. Wow. Of course, we'll continue that proper lengths all the way back to the mechanical room, but just showing how easy that is going to be to install. The concrete's going to embed around that. We're going to have ourselves a really nice, super warm floor. Most common in-floor heating designs are based on 300-foot loops, each loop covering roughly 200 to 300 square feet of surface. We're going to end up with about 6 loops here. We'll just take that pipe as it gets back towards that 300-foot level and take it back to the mechanical room. But really slick, easy way to get this installed. My brothers and I are actually going to be doing this on the weekend. We've just kind of simulated here for you to give you a sense. Derek, your thoughts? You've not used it before, but...
No, I think it works great.
Yeah. Very cool, just step on it and it seems to embed. Nice job.